see you. We're going to be looking and talking about, we're only going to cover four verses tonight. So feel free to speak up, raise your hand, ask a question, give an answer. We're just going to look at the eldership tonight. That's where we are in the book of Peter. Of course, it's going to be chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5. Then just for kicks, I thought we might try this song here. It's called Here I Am to Worship. Let me see where it is in your book. If you'd rather use your book, maybe you can't see that far. It's 179 in this book. 179 if you want to use the book instead of the screen. Poor niece there showing her age. She can't see that screen, so she's got it. You know, I didn't know what was going on, but when I first started going to Freed Hartman, I could see the screen just fine. And then I just thought, boy, I tell you what, the projector quality has just gotten more important. Oh, you know what? I got glasses, and all of a sudden that screen quality improved. All right, let's give this song a try. Need to turn this off or that'll be really bad. And that is what we're going to be talking about when it comes to what the elders do for us, what we need to do for them, our responsibility. So let's look at that. The elders which are among you, I exhort, who am also an elder. Now, Peter was also an apostle. So he had, if you will, the ability, just like Paul, remember in the letter to Philemon, he said, Philemon, I have the authority to enjoin you or to tell you that this is what you need to do. Peter was an apostle. He had authority, but he doesn't exercise that. As a matter of fact, when he's an elder, he's one of several elders wherever he was an elder at. We don't really know what congregation he was an elder at. But he wouldn't have been the only one. He wouldn't have been the chief elder. Because you see, the plurality of elders, they all have the same authority. There's not a chief elder, and then, you know, they're not ranked in position. So he says, who also am an elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ. Now, if you remember, one of the requirements of being an apostle was to be a witness. And of course, Peter was that indeed. He was with Jesus from the beginning of his ministry. And also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Goes on in verse 2 and says, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, in other words, grabbing folks in a headlock, if you will, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensembles to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. So let's begin by looking at elders in the New Testament. We're familiar with elders as members of the Lord's church, but sometimes we run across people that have no idea. They don't know that a pastor or an elder or a bishop or an overseer are talking about the exact same office. You see, they go wherever they go, and they don't have a church government set up like we find in the New Testament. And so their concept of deacons, I know when I was in the denominational era, our deacons were the folks that ran the church. You had a spiritual leader that was referred to as the pastor, or as we would call, they would call him the preacher. But he was looked at as the pastor, and he was kind of like you had an extra dose of the Holy Spirit, if you will. He was the spiritual leader. That's how most, I think, denominational groups kind of look at that today. Now, there are some that emphasize elders even more than the Bible does. They call themselves presbyterists or Presbyterian from the Greek word presbyteros. And that simply says we're set up with an elder type system. And you say, well, boy, I can appreciate that. They really look out for the eldership. They want to have elders. And with so many today don't have elders, that's a good thing. But then they kind of just throw that out the window when they do things like have female elders. As we know, one of the requirements of an elder, first of all, he must desire the work. And then secondly, he must be what? The husband of one wife. And that just absolutely destroys the idea of a woman, serving in the capacity of an elder. Notice the New Testament church was quickly organized with elders and deacons. They had a little extra help in the first century, didn't they? They had those miraculous gifts of faith and so forth. Notice in Acts 14:23, and when they had ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord on whom they believed. Now today we realize that elders are not to be a novice. It's not someone that's been newly converted. But that wasn't the case in the first century. Everybody was newly converted. If you were a Christian, you were on the ground floor, if you will, of the institution of the church. There was no people that had been members of the Lord's church for a long time. But you must remember that miraculous element. You had people who had the gift of faith. You had those who had the gift of preaching and so forth. And I believe that that had a lot to do with that. Always a plurality of elders. Sometimes you see folks today that, and I've always appreciated that about the church. We realize that you must have more than one elder. It's always referred to in the plural. That's why when we kind of get close to a couple elders, we start being concerned, because we realize if you have two elders and one dies, what happens to the eldership? For all practical purposes, it's dissolved. Because one man can't oversee the flock. So what you do in that case is you have basically male leadership. Is that what the church is designed for? Is that what God wanted? No. His desire is that we would have qualified men who would step into that role and guide the church. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of folks that step up in that regard. And one of the reasons is it starts out when you're young, doesn't it? You got to start preparing yourself. It's a good thing. It's something you got to want to do. It's something you have to put effort forth. And there's qualifications that must be met. And that's one of the reasons with our young men in particular, that we need to really stress the fact of their life and how they live their life and strive to be an elder in the Lord's church one day. That's the greatest work I believe that a man can take. It also has a tremendous, tremendous responsibility. But let's look at just a few of the verses that deal with the fact that the eldership is always plural. Acts 20 at verse 17, and this Paul was trying to make it back to Jerusalem, says, and from Miletus he sent to Ephesus. Now, he spent a lot of time at Ephesus. If you remember, he spent a year and a half at Corinth. You'd say, well, he couldn't have stayed anywhere. Yeah, he stayed at least 2 years in Ephesus. And he talked with those elders. And here he has them come out to meet him at an island so that he don't have to go all the way inland and he can just keep on going. He's trying to make the feast of Pentecost. So he's trying to get back. It says, and called the elders of the church. So the church at Ephesus had a plurality of elders. It says, and when we were come to Jerusalem, the brethren received us gladly. And the day following, Paul went in unto to James, and all the elders were present. You see, it's always referred to. In the book of Philippians, he addressed to the bishops and the deacons. The work of elders can be seen in the use of the terms. Think of the terms, and they're used interchangeably in Scripture. You don't have one office called an overseer, one called a bishop, and another office called elder, and they're just used interchangeably in the Scriptures. Notice the descriptions. We find elders, we find the word pastors, find the word bishops, we find the word overseers, and I think a word that is just, and all of them are fine words, but this one I've always thought was probably the best description for me as far as trying to sum it up of what an elder needs to be. He needs to be a shepherd. He shepherds the flock of God. Acts 20, verse 17 and 28, elders are called overseers. They're charged to shepherd the church. Notice as well, Titus 1, 5 through 7, notice the interchange. Talking about the same thing now. This is, there's two passages where we find the qualifications for elders. The first we probably think of the most, it would probably be 1 Timothy chapter 3. The second would be Titus chapter 1. Notice in this particular passage, it says, for this cause I left thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city. He's out of point of thee, talking to the preacher Titus. If any be blameless, and see, he starts naming the various requirements for the elder, husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must not, see, he hasn't changed subjects. He's talking about the very same thing. He has simply changed the words, the word that's used to describe that very same office. For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God. And goes on and continues with a list of qualifications for the elder. Notice where elders are told to shepherd the flock, serving as overseers. That's what we've just read in 1 Peter chapter 5. As older men, therefore, they are to watch over the flock, to tend the sheep. So you've got to know the sheep, to tend the sheep, and then you've got to be an overseer. You've got to take care of the flock of God. Our responsibility, first of all, is to recognize and to respect them. Respect them for the work's sake. That's one of the things I've tried to preach my whole time preaching, is that, brethren, you should love me because not that I'm the greatest preacher or not that I'm a great guy or something, but for the work's sake. Same thing with elders. Love them, appreciate what they're trying to do. They may not be very good at it. You know, there's some people that play baseball, paid millions of dollars and don't hit 250. You know, they come up to the plate and you're just like, you know, somebody's got a bat in the 7, 8, 9 hole, right? They're just not the best hitters in the world, but they're on the team, they've got a bat, so you put them in order. You lead off, the guy gets on the most. You're number two, somebody can move him over, and it's pretty consistent at the plate. Number three needs to be your best hitter, and four is there to clean up. They have a role, but they're all on the team. Well, it's the same thing when it comes to elders. You love them for their work's sake. The preacher, the deacons, you love them for their work's sake. You may say, but he stinks. He can't preach his way out of a wet bag. That's not the point. It's what he's trying to do. So recognize them and respect them. Respect them because of the office. You know, there have been some presidents that I haven't been too crazy about, but I respected the office. Had I been in the service and they had gone by, I would have saluted them. That was part of your job requirement. You know, it's a part of the office. You appreciate and you respect the office. You may not be happy with the people that are in it. You may not be happy with our local officials, but you respect the office. You may not like the policeman that just pulled you over. In fact, that's usually my least favorite people when they're pulling me over, my least favorite policeman. But you need to respect the position and what they're trying to do. Notice in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 12 says, "And we beseech you, brethren, know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you." Know these guys. Try to get to know them. Try to be their friend. Try to encourage them in the work that they do. "And to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake." There's the idea. Maybe you don't like them. Maybe personalities clash. Maybe there's something, you know, you just never have jeed and hawed. But respect the position and respect what they're trying to do and help them do it. Don't be a hindrance. If you think they can't preach for nothing, give them encouragement. Try to tell them something that'll build them up to help them do better. Maybe you know an elder you think isn't eldering like you think they ought to. Give them encouragement. Tell them what you think ought to happen and how that you'd love to help them do that very thing. "But to esteem them very highly in their work's sake and be at peace among yourselves." You want to help an eldership out? Be at peace among yourselves. That's one of the most difficult things that an elder has to deal with, is infighting and bickering inside the congregation. And we just don't want to do that. We want to try to make their job as stress-free as possible, because they're like us, only human, and they have other things going on in their life as well. Verse 17, we drop down a little further, says, "Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine." So here we have a scripture that teaches that the elders in some places, not only were the elders, but they also were the preachers. Not only that, but they were paid. Sometimes elders, there's actually more authority in the New Testament for paying elders. I shouldn't say more authority. It's mentioned more. How's that? More evidence, I guess we could say, of elders being supported by the congregation than for the preacher, a located preacher. That's something we don't practice a whole lot, but it's very biblical. And especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. Notice verse 18, "For the scripture saith, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the labor is worthy of his reward." One of the reasons this 1 Timothy 5:18 is a great thing to remember is because there, Paul, writing to Timothy, is quoting another New Testament book. That's not Old Testament. He's quoting from the book of Luke. And in the labor is worthy of his reward. Check that out. It's just another one of those instances where the apostles thought they were writing scripture. Peter says, you know, Paul's written many things hard to be understood. Well, I think Peter wrote a thing or two that was kind of hard to understand. It's just one of those passages that's good to keep in mind. We go on, verse 19, "Against an elder receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses." In other words, don't be gossiping, don't be backbiting, don't be going around accusing elders of this or that or the other. As a matter of fact, if somebody has an accusation, let that be done two or three people. Keep everything above board. You know, in the mouth of two witnesses, let everything be confirmed. Verse 20, "Them that sin rebuke before all, that others also may fear." It's interesting in that context, he's talking about an elder that's been rebuked. Do that, and it needs to be done. If there's a problem, let it be very known. Don't let it be some kind of secret thing. And when it's done, do it, you know, that everybody understands what's going on, that others may also fear. Going on, not only do we need to recognize, respect our elders, but we need to obey and be submissive when they lead scripturally. It's a good thing to not give them a hard time. They got enough to worry about. Hebrews 13:17 says, "Obey them that have the rule over you." I want you to remember this verse, okay? We'll probably come back to it. But Hebrews 13:17, obey them. That's where me and you come in. We're required, you know. If it's a matter that's not of faith, it's just an expedient way to do something. They say, hey, let's meet at, you know, a certain time, or this is the order of worship, or we're going to, you know, do this or do that. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. The reason I bring that up is because somebody that I have a lot of respect for, he's a Hebrew and Greek scholar, I think he may have passed. But has he died, Robbie, as far as you? I know he's got to be older than he is. Jim, what was his name? Now I've drawn a complete blank. Well, Anyway, we've got a guy who taught at Harding University for 100 million years. I want it. I've drawn a complete blank. What's that? Jack Lewis. I had the J. I kept wanting to say Jim. I knew it wasn't Jim Lewis. He's in Chattanooga. Jack Lewis, who I just think the world of. He's got some good material out there. Let me tell you something. If you ever see Jack Lewis's name on a book, buy it. And then you can, you know, the few places where he's got some issues. But one of them's in the eldership. And he is an elder. It's kind of amazing. But he would say that the elders don't have authority in the sense of authority. That the only way that they can rule, or the only way that they do lead or rule, is by example. And he would appeal to these four verses that we're looking at for authority. But there's too many other places where the Bible, I don't believe that's what verses 1 through 4 teach of chapter 5, but it certainly is saying something different here in Hebrews 13, 17, isn't it? Obey. There is a real sense of authority in which these men are in charge. And we need to observe that. Now, if they, you know, as long as it's scriptural, if they say, you know, we're going to put up a statue of Mary and everybody's got to kiss her toe when they walk in, well, then they've left the room of expedience and have moved into matters of faith, and you can't do that. And of course, and so, but when they're doing their jobs and doing it scripturally, we need to obey and submit ourselves. Submit yourself, for they watch over your souls. It's tough enough watching over your own soul, trying to keep yourself straight. These men have taken on responsibility where they are going to have to give an account of what they've done in regards to your soul. Isn't that amazing? As they must give an account that they may do it with joy and not with grief. Wouldn't it be great if all of us would live in such a way as the elders don't have to wonder about where we are. They don't have to be worried about where we are doctrinally. They don't have to worry about us teaching false doctrine or anything of that. That they could do their jobs and do it with joy and that they wouldn't have grief. It says, for that is unprofitable for you. Well, why is that? Well, you put a man in an environment where he's constantly under pressure. Nobody will work with him. Everybody's agitated and backbiting all the time. What's that man going to do? He's going to burn out, isn't he? I mean, this is natural. Any of you ever had a boss like that, just constantly on you? You know the stress level, how hard it was to function that way? Well, you do that, we do that with our elders, and that's exactly what's going to happen. These men are going to burn out. They're not going to be able to keep going. That's why one of the first requirements, you must desire the office. A man that's subjected to that and constantly being berated and so forth, he's not going to desire that anymore. Notice verse 5 says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject to one to another. But notice we're supposed to submit ourselves to the elders. And that's one of the things that I just don't see Brother Lewis didn't get. My belief is sometimes preachers can have a bad experience or something, you know, and kind of get pushed into a corner on something and then just take a bad position and run with it. And I believe that's exactly what happened with him. Let's move on. Peter's exhortation to the elders here. Notice, shepherd the flock of God to lead. And, of course, of being one of the requirements of an elder is that they're apt to teach. That's one of the ways that elders can lead. They're supposed to stop the mouths of the gainsayers. In other words, just think of what a different world it could be if the places where Mike Cope and Drupal Shelley and these guys had preached, if the elders had said, hey, listen, son, we need to talk to you for a moment. Now, you're saying some things here that just ain't right. Now, either you're going to have to quit saying that or you're going to have to move on, because we're not going to allow that to be taught from our pulpit. We don't want the sheep being led to the, you know, being the, or the, what do you call that, the led to the fox, or the sheep led to the wolves. Unfortunately, a lot of times that's not the case, but that's the elder's responsibility. Notice, must take heed to themselves. So there's a self-inventory. It's even heightened over just a regular member. Why is that? Because you not only have to examine yourself, but you got to examine, what am I doing as far as the congregation goes? So it's a weighty, weighty responsibility that these men have taken. Notice, take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost. So it's a heightened responsibility. Notice, which is among you. No elder or overseer has authority outside of the congregation. This is what got the first century church into trouble, and it's been getting people into trouble ever since. There's very few religious organizations out there that are what we would call autonomous. And that is, like we are here, The South Pittsburgh congregation does not call the Bridgeport congregation and ask them what we can do on Sunday mornings or what our sermon topics ought to be. However, if you were in some denominations, that's exactly what's being done. They're told what they can preach, what they can teach. There's been a real rift going on. I'm anxious to see where it ends up with the Methodist church, because you've got a lot of Methodists that are, you know, old-time, believe the Word of God kind of people, and when the Bible says that homosexuality is wrong, they're saying, you know, we think that's what that means, but their convention and so forth are voting that that's not the case, so you've got a lot of folks pulling out. They want to pull out, but guess what? They're having a lot of trouble, and the reason is, well, the denomination owns the building, owns the property. And if you're familiar with the Methodist church, they also have the circuit preachers. They move the preacher here, from here, over there, and over there. And so they're saying you can't leave. If you do leave, you'll be leaving without that building. And so it's caused a lot of problems. They're not autonomous. They're run by a umbrella, if you will. There's folks that they receive their instruction from. But not in the New Testament. An overseer, an elder, is only an overseer or elder at the congregation he serves. Acts 20, verse 28, take heed to the flock over which the Holy Ghost, not the various congregations round about. And if you just spend a little time with church history, it's pretty easy to see that the church at Ephesus, for instance, would have their preacher or head elder, which wasn't supposed to be but happened, because he was over a large congregation. He would have great influence over those smaller congregations round about. And so you started having these areas that where one elder in that area was known as the leader. And so when they started getting together in the various places, Nicene or Rome or wherever, this guy would be elected to go as a representative for this group, and they started voting on things, and that's how that began. And it was something that God never intended. Well, notice sent to Ephesus and called the elders, those elders at Ephesus. So they were to serve as overseers, oversight. Notice it is a servant. Being an elder is one of a servant, not of a lord, not by constraint, but willingly. Notice a man cannot be forced to serve as an elder. It's not, we can't constrain them to do that. It's something they've got to want to do. He must desire the office. I want you to look at these three verses. Only three times this word, it looks like arego. I believe that may be how you pronounce it. But 1 Timothy 3:1, the desire be an elder, that's one time. The second time is says, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after. So that word is translated desire in 1 Timothy 3 is translated coveted in 1 Timothy 6. And then Hebrews 11, verse 16, but now they desire a better country. So you get the idea what that word's talking about. It's got to be something that you want to do. You want to be an elder. And notice the minute he loses the desire, he probably should think of resigning. Why is that? Because, well, he doesn't meet that first qualification anymore. That's why it's important that we treat our elders like we love them, so that they don't have that added pressure and get burned out and don't want to do it anymore. Be an encouragement and not a discouragement. And notice, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly. One of the things, you know, an elder, of course, as we looked at earlier, can be supported for his work. And that's one of the things that Peter's cautioning against. Paul is commenting there in 1 Timothy, this to be done. But Peter's saying don't do that as a motive. And, of course, that's almost one of those things that comes without saying. And notice, not as being lords over those entrusted to you. Peter could have told them what to do, but instead practice what he preached, not to be a dictator. A sobering thought is the trust that is put to their care, and that is for our souls. Many have made this a sugar stick passage. We've already talked about Brother Lewis. He's the one that really comes to mind. Oh, there's many people that hold that position, but he kind of was the champion of it, if you will. And so folks that appeal to that will appeal to his writings and so forth. They run from one side where the elders have authority, and they run to the other side and say they have no authority, no authority whatsoever. Well, that'd be kind of hard to do. They're upset with elders, lord over the flock, and they've seen that happen. Say, well, we can't have that, so we're just going to say the elders have no authority. Well, that's not right either. Not right either. So let's don't be accused of that. But notice Jesus called them unto him and says, you know how the princes of the Gentiles exercises dominion over them, but that's not how it's going to be with you. Those who would be great among you, let them be your ministers. That's the idea of an elder, is a minister. Same thing as a preacher. Those that are over you are your ministers. They're your servants, if you will. And whosoever will be a chief among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. That's one of the great stories, I think, of the New Testament. We read, put all the accounts together of that last night that Jesus is free. He's meeting with his disciples. It's his last meeting. It's so important to him. Emotions are high. He knows what's fixing to happen. And yet, on the way up there, they're arguing about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. Imagine that. 3.5 years you've got training these men, and you're trying to get them the idea of servitude, of being a servant, and they're trying to figure out who's going to be chief on the totem pole. And so what does he have to do? They go up there and they eat with each other in nasty feet. Nasty feet laying beside nasty feet, because nobody would be a servant and wash their feet for them. So what does he do? He does it. And of course Peter sees that. So, oh, wait a minute, Lord, you're not going to wash me. You remember, Jesus said, well, if you don't let me wash your feet, you're not a part of me. And he said, well, not just my feet, you know, wash me all over. Remember what Jesus says to him? You're not dirty all over, just your feet. Something that should have been done, but they wouldn't do it because they didn't want to be a minister. They didn't want to fill the role that he was trying to get them to see was so important. He gave his life a ransom for many. Notice here you have a perfect example of that coming to fruition. The sons of Zebedee, she comes, worship him, desiring that what? One would sit on his one hand and one on the other hand. You remember what Jesus told her, right? It's not mine to give. But you are going to have to go through some pretty difficult things. Notice Peter's exhortation to elders, be an example to the flock. Just as sheep are led and not driven, so it is with people. I know some folks, and you know them as well. I've got a good friend. I love him to death. But I quit trying to tell him anything a long time ago. I try to show him. You know what I'm saying? He's one of those guys, if he's going to be in a fight, you'd want him on your side. But you're not going to convince him of anything. What you've got to do is give him the information, give him the proof, and he'll come out on the right side of it. But same things with a lot of folks. You got to lead them, not drive them. The elders have to live the life of a faithful Christian and lead by their example. And, of course, motivation to heed the exhortation, here is that motivation. For elders, for us, when the chief shepherd shall appear, what's he talking about? Chief shepherd, that's Jesus. He's the chief shepherd. When he shall appear, he shall receive a crown of glory that shall fade not away. For the elders, they're going to receive double portion, if you will, double honor. They've got a tough job. For the rest of us, if we want our crown of glory, well, we're going to have to submit to the very men that we've been talking about here. Those who serve as elders are certainly worthy of the crown of glory. Hopefully, as we better understand their work, we will esteem them very highly in love for their sakes. Remember, brethren, that's why you do it. It's not because you may think he's the greatest elder in the world or the greatest preacher or the greatest deacon, but we esteem them for the job that they're trying to do and make it as easy as possible for them to do that work, because it is not an easy work. If we understand their work, we will obey and be submissive so they can watch out for our souls, do the important thing. Maybe you're here tonight, not a New Testament Christian. Well, the plan of salvation is something that we talk about a lot around here. I hope you've gotten something from the fact that of what Peter's trying to encourage these brethren to do here. But all of that's for naught if we don't obey the gospel, if we're not a Christian. Elders give us great examples, and it's a good thing to follow that example. It's what we want to do. But follow the greatest example. Greatest example of Jesus submitting himself to God. The elders submit themselves to Christ. We submit ourselves to the elders. And it's something that's the idea of becoming a Christian, submitting. You know, it's nothing that you do, you allow to be done. Just submit to what God would have you to do. And what is that? Obey the gospel. When you're baptized, you're not doing anything besides submitting to somebody putting you underwater and bringing you up out of it. The Bible actually has you, the Greek verb tense there is passive. In other words, it's not active. It's not you the one doing the work. You're having the work done to you. Somebody's putting you under the water and bringing you back up. But who's doing the real work? God Almighty. Faith in the operation of God. Colossians chapter 2 verse 12. He's the one that puts the energy, the force behind the remission of sins in baptism. If you're not a child of God, let me encourage you. You cannot make jobs of elders any easier by refusing to obey the gospel. As a matter of fact, you worry them. You concern them. They know that you're in a position that you need to obey the gospel, and you're not making their job easier. Perhaps as a Christian, you've obeyed the gospel in times past, but you're not living your life like you ought to. You know, there's probably a lot more people that know that. You know, I used to like to think nobody knew that, you know, the things I was doing when I was younger. People know. People talk. You're not making the lives of the elders any easier by not being what you ought to be. Maybe you're here tonight, you need something that we could help you with. That's why we're going to sing this invitation song to help you in any way that we can. Would you come as together we stand and sing?